today's talk will focus on two activities that have a lot of things in common. Basically, both of them involve the use of individual electron spins for doing quantum information science and metrology. So, you know, as a means of a general introduction, you all know that any two-level system is a good candidate for a quantum bit, but for really a two-level system to qualify as a quantum bit, it needs to satisfy a list of criteria that I've outlined here. We need to be able to control it. We need to be able to initialize and to be able to create arbitrary superpositions nicely represented by this block sphere. We need to be able to read out the state of that two-level system, ideally for many of the things that we would like to do with multiple qubits, such as error correction. We'd like to have single-shot readout of these systems. If we'd like to store some information in these systems, we'd like to have long coherence. And of course, in order to do universal operations, we would need not only a single qubit, but we need some piece of physics that allows us to couple between two qubits, and that in general could be described as some means of generating arbitrary superpositions of two qubit states. Now, over the course of many years now, there have been quite a few implementations, and I've listed some of them here, but the focus of this talk would be one particular implementation where we're going to be looking at few electron spins in solids, and in fact, there are many, many possibilities even there. So that subfield in itself is huge. You're probably familiar with phosphorus spins in silicon when one can use either the electron spin or the nuclear spin as a quantum bit. I'll be talking about gallium arsenide artificially confined quantum dots. I'll also be talking about nitrogen vacancy centers, but other implementations could involve quantum dots in nanowires, carbon nanotubes, or other semiconducting wires. One can envision using endohedral fullerenes where one could trap an additional atom within the cage, and that would have an independent spin. So the field is very, very rich. Our focus on spins in solids stems from the fact that there are quite a lot of condensed matter that we can take advantage of in terms of controlling this system. So one example, of course, is just the entire technology that goes together with fabrication. Typically, the quantum bits that you will see here are fairly small compared to other implementations, superconducting quantum bits or trapped ions, for example. Our quantum bits are of order 100 nanometers, so you need quite a good set of tools in order to be able to control and manipulate charges on that length scale. One could take advantage of the solid, the interaction of the charge within the solid, in order to control the properties of the spins. And examples include, for example, spin orbit coupling, where one could then translate the motion, the orbital motion of the electron, in order to drive spin rotations. One could use the exchange interaction. This is yet another piece of physics, interactions among two electrons in order to drive rotations. You can imagine that the semiconductor has position-dependent g-factors. This is something that one knows how to do. And then again, you can control, imagine turning on and off spin knobs simply by moving the electronic wave functions in space. I'll also be talking about hyperfine interaction. There is some interesting interaction with the nuclear sublattice that also allows us to gain functionality. Of course, there are additional advantages whereby one could use, for example, the ability to convert charge to light in order to communicate quantum bits and to store using some mechanism to transfer information from electron spins to nuclear spins. So again, I think the environment, the solid state environment, is really a rich playground to be able to manipulate electron spins. But this, of course, comes at a cost. If you have something that interacts very effectively with your spin, and forgive me for the dark colors, but if you have something that interacts very effectively with your electron, this, of course, would also lead to decoherence. And you know, the entire game of quantum bits and quantum information science is, on one hand, being able to control the system, but on the other hand, being able to decouple it very effectively from its environment in order to preserve coherence. And you'll see today that we could basically do both. In this particular system, we're going to be using both in diamond and in gallium arsenide we're going to both gain some functionality from the surrounding bath, as well as be able to decouple from the environment in order to preserve coherence. And one of the unique things that I'll be discussing a little bit more in detail is that this nuclear environment, this bath that basically decoheres, tends to decoheres the electron spin, has some unique properties that allows us to very effectively decouple from it on one hand, and on the other hand, extract functionality from it so that we can gain control. It is something that is not a general property of any bath, but it is the property of the nuclear bath in these systems. Now, you might ask, well, is single electron spin the best quantum bit one can imagine? And of course, it is a good quantum bit, and there are groups working to use individual electrons as quantum bits. The controls, if one would imagine, just storing one electron. And you can think of storing electrons in a semiconductor environment as the solid state realization of trapped ions. Okay, it's a charge, it's a solid state version where we trap one electron in a box. And of course, using ESR, we could manipulate that spin. But you see, if you want to be able to initialize that spin, for example, you'd need to have a Zeeman energy, the splitting between the up and down spin states, to exceed the temperature. And typical temperatures, you know, we can cool down things pretty well, but it's hard to cool them down much below 100 millikelvin if you want to be able to drive them with high frequency. And already there, it means that you need to have fairly large ESR frequencies in order to drive the system. So the combination of very high ESR frequencies and you need to modulate some magnetic field and the fact that you want the temperature to be low makes this particular implementation a little bit challenging. But nonetheless, there are groups who are working on that. One could make the system a little bit more complex. One could say, well, okay, we can enlarge our Hilbert space. Instead of having a system that indeed only has two states, spin up and spin down, let's consider two electron states. These have the entire Hilbert space is spanned by four states, one singlet, three triplets. If we have some way of isolating two states out of the four, then that would constitute a logical quantum bit. And what we, of course, suffer from that is the difficulty in isolating only two out of the four states. But as you'll see, what we gain is simplicity and control. We'll see that the control of this quantum bit requires some combination, effectively only electrical pulsing. There is some permanent magnetic component in the system, but it does not require an oscillating magnetic field as the single electron implementation requires. And I'll talk about that in greater detail. And one can make, you know, follow this through even further. One could ask, well, why not use more electrons? And again, if you think about three electrons, they would now have a Hilbert space consisting of altogether eight states. One can again isolate only two out of the eight. The challenge is being only within that subspace, but what one gains, again, is simplicity and control. And for three spins, it can be shown under particular implementations that only exchange interaction are sufficient. So not only you don't need to oscillate magnetic field, you don't need even to have a permanent magnetic field or magnetic field gradients. You can only use electric fields to control this system. And again, there are some groups that are interested in this particular implementation. So the field is very broad in terms of implementation. All right, so the first few electron system that I'll be describing is the electrons in gallium arsenide. I'll then describe some very similar physics that takes place for nitrogen vacancy centers in diamond. The way we create these systems is by patterning some top gates that allow us to deplete the 2D underneath and then basically confine two electrons within the box. We're basically interested only in having two electrons in this box, so it turns out that it's not so easy to generate these kind of confinement potentials that only leave two electrons in the box, but I think we've become quite good at doing that now. So here is the essentially the four states that I was describing, one singlet, three triplets. And if one wants to characterize what the energies associated with these four states, then we need to consider two possible charge configurations for these two electrons. They could, in this double dot geometry, there are two positions where each electron can sit. So we can imagine having them, two of them sitting on the right, none on the left. That would be this kind of 0-2, no electrons on the left, two on the right. We could then pulse these gates to imbalance the electrostatic potential and move charges around in this double well potential. And what's shown here is a measurement of the charge configuration that's being done using some nearby charge sensor that basically just senses the electrostatic environment and can do it very effectively. We can identify what the charge configuration is very easily. And already you see some of the difficulty here is that we're interested in spin. We know how to measure charge, so we will have to find some way of converting the spin information to charge in order to say something about the spin states of the system. In the O2 configuration, because the two electrons are so tightly confined, one can easily see that the singlet state, which is an anti-symmetric spin state, occupies the lower orbital state. The two electrons are both in the lowest orbital state of the quantum. Well, the triplet states, being symmetric in spin, need to occupy the next excited state, and that's why all three of them are separated by fairly large energy here of order a few Kelvin. This energy difference serves to initialize our system. We can very easily, when we're positioning ourselves in this 0-2 configuration, we're very, very precisely initializing the system in the O2 singlet. So we know how to prepare the system and initialize it very effectively. As we're biasing this control parameter, epsilon, essentially detuning this electrostatic potential, we can push one electron all the way to the other side. And now the two electrons separate one with respect to the other. And now, because there is no overlap anymore between the two electrons, all four spin states become degenerate. So we have altogether four states in the 1-1 configuration, and effectively only one in the O2 configuration. And if you now turn on some tunneling, you see that the singlet states hybridize. We get an avoided crossing. And of course, the triplet states also hybridize, but they hybridize at a much different value of this detuning parameter. And we're going to restrict ourselves only to this low values of epsilon so that we're only dealing with this lowest branch of the singlet state and the triplet states in the 1-1 configuration only. Now, basically, this low energy range of this diagram is the mechanism by which we can easily convert spin to charge. Imagine that we load an arbitrary pair of electrons in this 1-1 configuration. This means that they could either be in a singlet or in a triplet. If we now pulse the system to this 0-2 configuration, we're trying to push one electron onto the other. What we find is that if the two electrons were prepared in a singlet state, then they will move on to the O2 charge configuration. But if they were in one of the three triplet states, they will be stuck in 1-1. Even though we try to pulse them, they won't go. We need to detune this parameter even further until they would go. And I want to emphasize that this is really a transient phenomenon. If we just stop here for a short period of time, of course, the two electrons will remain in this excited state, but eventually some spin flip process will take place, and then we will relax down to the ground state. And so the spin to charge conversion is a transient phenomenon as long as, and here I show this transient phenomenon, if you just measure a period, let's say, of order 10 microseconds and not more, then you see that this O2 configuration has a color which is somewhere between the 1-1 and the O2, indicating that we're randomly preparing singlets and triplets. And so on average, the signal when we're pulsing from the 1-1 to the O2 configuration hovers somewhere between the 1-1, which will be the triplets, and the O2, which will be the singlets. Now, so far we have out here four states. We want to remain only with two out of the four. And so the way we do that is we invoke Zeeman splitting. We apply an external magnetic field that splits the two, the three triplets into three lines here. And if we ignore for now, we'll come back to that a little bit later, we ignore the T plus and the T minus, the two triplet states for which the electron spins are parallel, we end up with a nice two-level system that's shown here. One energy state is this hybridized singlet that we can control its energy going from a charge configuration 0-2 to 1-1, and the triplet states that are always the 1-1 configuration. So that's our two-level system. It's not that intuitive, and so in order to give some intuition, basically our qubit, the 0 and the 1 states, are now a singlet and a triplet. They're two electron states. They're not a single spin state. And the unique feature about this system is that there is a regime here for which it becomes a pure spin quantum bit. In this 1-1 regime, you see that the wave function of the singlet and the triplet are identical. There is no difference in their energy, and there is no difference in what the charge configuration of that system is. And so this system is completely immune to charge fluctuations. But anywhere outside this far left range here, when there is a little bit of an energy difference, then you see that the singlets acquire a little bit of an O2 flavor and the triplets do not. And so this charge difference is useful for us, for example, to couple between two qubits, and I'll talk about that a little bit later in greater detail. To give you a feel of how this quantum bit works, I've created an analogy here between a regular spin-half system and our two electrons quantum bit. For a regular spin-half system, we'd like to form arbitrary superpositions of an up and a down state. And we need, of course, two knobs on the block sphere. One could be a Zeeman splitting that creates an energy difference between the two states. The analogous picture for the singlet triplet quantum bit, we'd like now to form arbitrary superpositions of two electron states, the singlet and T0. And we already see that this exchange coupling, right, this energy difference between the singlet and the triplet in this double dot geometry is analogous to this Zeeman effect here. So we have our sigma Z operator is essentially an exchange field. And we can turn it on and off very, very rapidly, unlike this case. This could be done in sub-nanosecond timescales easily. But we need another knob. So on the block sphere here, we had a magnetic field for the spin-half system that separates the energy of the up and the down state. If we wanted to drive rotations around x, we, for example, can imagine having some magnetic field along x, and that would do it. So we need to identify what is the physical operator that controls x rotations in this Hilbert space here, singlets and T0. And the way you can think about it is just let's identify what the eigenstates are first. And the eigenstates along x are real superpositions of the north and the south pole. That's what gives us the eigenstate along x here. The same can be done here. So if we look at what the real superposition of the north and south pole is, just the sum of a singlet plus a T0. If we write it down in terms of the individual electron spins, we see that we end up with an up-down state along x and a down-up state along minus x. So the operator that favors up-down versus down-up is just a field gradient. It's very easy to see that in the presence of a magnetic field gradient, the lower energy state would be one spin aligned with the high field side and the other spin aligned with the low field side. And of course, the reverse would correspond to the low energy state. And so a magnetic field gradient constitutes the knob that rotates this quantum bit around x, and the exchange field is what gives us z rotations. Okay? So this is a little bit unique. Typically in quantum bits, rotations are driven by the same kind of operator. If you think about a spin-half system, this could be some oscillating magnetic field. This would drive both rotations around x and z or y. Here we have two very different physical mechanisms, and so in principle, we need to consider fluctuations and noise sources associated with each one of these driving fields. I will not talk about fluctuations in the exchange field here today. I will mainly focus on fluctuations in this gradient field and how we can decouple from them. But in principle, we also need to consider fluctuations in the exchange field that drive our Z rotations. Okay, so how do we operate this quantum bit? Just to give you an example, as I said, if we go to this O2 regime, it's as if we have a huge exchange field on. This energy is very large, and so we can easily align our spinner along the north pole. And then if we now turn off that exchange field rapidly by just pulsing the system towards 1-1, and I said we could do it very fast, we will rotate around whatever magnetic field gradient that exists in the system. And already there is a hint here, there is a nuclear magnetic field present in the system simply because each electron sees of order a million nuclear spins. And so there is some reminiscence, some leftover magnetic field gradient between the two quantum dots that's of order a few millitesla. And so within that magnetic field, the electron, or this quantum bit, this singlet triplet quantum bit, processes at a rate of around 10 nanoseconds. It will complete one revolution. Now, the problem with this nuclear field is that, of course, it's not constant. And so if we run this experiment several times, you see what happens. Here, I've just overlaid several iterations. Each one of them has a different field gradient because of this nuclear fluctuations. Just the spins of the nuclei are not controllable in this experiment. And you see that we're basically going to spread out across this plane. And so if we just ask, well, what is the probability of finding our spin system on average after some time, either in the north or south pole, we're going to get a half very quickly on the time scale of roughly 10 nanoseconds, we're going to measure a half. So we lose spin information very rapidly simply because our nuclear field gradients are not stationary, they're fluctuating. But this is one of these things that we'd like to undo somehow. So one thing that, of course, most of you or all of you are very familiar is we can undo very low frequency, very slow fluctuations using echo. And so we could basically follow the same experiment, just let the system evolve in whatever gradient field exists. But if these gradients are changing very slowly in time, we can then pulse back and turn on some exchange field here and basically pi rotate all the spins around the z-axis and then turn the exchange field back off and refocus all the spin back to the North Pole. This is going to give us, you know, a measure of the fluctuations, but in a higher frequency range of the spectrum. Okay, and this is important because if you are successful in eliminating some of the decoherence by doing these kind of echo experiments, it basically tells you that there is a lot of noise, a lot of weight of the noise of your bath at low frequency, but there maybe isn't that much at high frequency. So here's how these echo experiments look. And now you see the time scales are very, very different. Instead of being losing the spin information on a scale of a few nanoseconds, you see that now the time scale becomes a few tens of microseconds. So that's three orders of magnitude longer. And there are several interesting things that we can note as we vary both the echo time and as we vary the magnetic field. So starting from high magnetic field, you see that we are recovering full spin coherence for times of order 30 microseconds. And note that the decay of this echo, the decay of this spin memory, is extremely flat in the beginning, and then it drops off. In fact, if one looks at it quantitatively, one finds that this is the envelope of the echo. It goes as some high power of t over t2, t2 being the measure of the coherence time. And this immediately tells us, again, there is a very direct relation, at least for classical noise sources. There is a direct relation between the power that appears here and the nature of the spectrum. What is the spectral content of the system? In principle, if this was just a pure exponential decay, namely this power was unity, then the spectral noise of the bath would be white, would be frequency independent, and then echoes will not help at all. High power here means that the spectral weight of this noise is dying off very rapidly, of order 1 over omega cube, and so the more pulses that we introduce into the system, going, let's say, from one echo to many echoes, we can even reduce coherence further. And this is an example. We've done this experiment with order 10 of these pi pulses, and we pushed coherence up from 30 to about 300 microseconds. And so with this kind of slow dynamical bath, the notion of T2 becomes a little bit misleading, because it's not really, the system is not characterized by a coherence time. In fact, we can prolong coherence as much as we want, as long as we have good control. But basically, yeah, I think the important lesson here is that our bath is a very slowly varying bath. It's what's called non-Markovian. And that means that we can decouple more and more effectively from the bath and do controlled operations that are less and less sensitive to the bath, basically to a degree that it is at our control. Just to say a few words about what eventually is causing this coherence. So what's causing the coherence has nothing to do with the electron itself. These are just flip-flops between the nuclear spins. If you think about two nuclear spins here, what happens is that you can have basically spin diffusion just through dipole-dipole interactions among the nuclear spins, and that changes the local magnetic environment that the electron sees and leads to decoherence. And as I mentioned, this alpha here, this exponent for gallium arsenide, is predicted to be 4. It turns out that, for example, if you look at a central spin problem, electron spin in silicon, then the power is lower, is of order 2.3. It has been actually seen and measured by Steve Lyons, and it has to do with the specific block wave function, really the details of the electronic wave function inside the semiconductor that governs this kind of power law. So it's not universal, but yet it's predictable and seems to agree very well with experiment. Now, as we lower magnetic field, we see that there's another feature that comes in, and these are these oscillations. And it turns out that these oscillations, again, are directly related to the nuclear bath. This time, they're telling us something different. This is the interaction between the nuclear spin and the electron spin. These are known as flip-flop terms. You can conserve angular momentum by taking an electron spin and nuclear spin and having both of them flip. The problem is that you won't conserve energy in this process because the electron G factor is 1,000 times larger than the nuclear one. So the first order, these kind of flip-flop terms are forbidden. But one can always go to second order and expand this to second order, which basically leaves the electron spin in the same state. Effectively, what happens is we, for a very short time, we flip the electron spin, but then another nuclear spin flips the electron spin back. So overall, the electron spin did not flip, but two fairly remote nuclear spins have undergone a flip-flop. So now this is not directly mediated by dipole interaction between the two nuclear spins. Now it's mediated by the electron. But you can see that what happens here is that the entire term here to the right looks like an effective magnetic field that's due to the nuclear spins, but there is acting along the quantization axis of the electron. And so there is a very natural semi-classical picture that one can imagine that takes place here. And basically, we just need to see, well, what are these nuclear spins? What is the effective magnetic field that all this ensemble of nuclear spins are producing relative to the electron? And it turns out that the ensemble semi-classical sum of all these nuclear spins is oscillating in time because there is an external magnetic field in this net magnetization of the nuclei is just processing rather slowly in time. And each time there is some commensurability between the precession frequency of the nuclear spins and the electron, there is some recurrence. So with these oscillations, and you'll see them more later when I talk about NV centers, these are basically some very slow and coherent dynamics of the nuclear bath and the way that dynamics interacts with the electron. And again, you see that there is a solid line here that goes through the data points, and that's theory. And so theory works very well to describe these kind of recurrences in this particular system. Now, so far, I've talked about basically the interaction of the electron with a bath, and I've indicated that we can very effectively decouple the electron from the bath and prolong coherence as much as we like. We can basically determine T2 at our will. But in order to control our quantum bit, remember, rotations around x-axis are governed currently by some nuclear field fluctuations. That's not acceptable because these fluctuations are fast. And so in order to preserve the spin state, we can decouple, but eventually we want to do a quantum operation. We need to be able to do that with high fidelity. So we need to basically be able to create gradients that are stable in time and not fluctuating in time. And so what comes to our aid here is the fact that one of the triplet branches that we've thrown out before, this T plus, necessarily intersects the singlet branch, and you see it here. Whereas they're just tangent to one another, T0 in the singlet state, the T plus necessarily intersects. And this is a very interesting intersection. And if you think that there is some coupling between these two states, so let's think about it as an avoided crossing, this splitting is very, very small. But nonetheless, we can try and go adiabatically through this crossing. Before, what happened is to go to this point here, we just flew by. And so we Zener tunneled, we ignore this transition at all, but now let's go actually quite slowly through it and see what this means. And so one possibility would be to prepare a singlet, and if we go slowly through this process, we go adiabatically, we are going to end up in a triplet state. So we started out with one electron pointing up and the other one down, and we end up with the two electrons pointing up. Okay? So something must take away angular momentum because one electron spin flipped. We don't know whether it was on the right dot or the left dot because we started out with the singlet, but what we are sure about is that we have flipped the one electron spin flipped, and so the only way that we can conserve angular momentum is by having one of the nuclear spins flip in the opposite direction. So this is a way directly to flip one nuclear spin at a time. We can run this as a pump. We can basically run to this triplet state, throw out two electrons, load back a singlet, run it again. And so we could just, per cycle, try to polarize one nuclear spin at a time, known as dynamic nuclear polarization. This is all electrically driven, not optically driven. We can run the pump in one direction, going from singlets to triplets. We could also run it from triplets to singlets, which will then flip nuclear spins in the opposite direction, animated here. So we have a way of pumping up and pumping down, And when we do that, we can indeed see that instead of this decay that we saw before, that the average behavior of the system did not have a particular frequency. We just saw decay to a half. Now we see that there is some oscillation. You'll see some nicer curves in just a minute. But basically, the point here is to show that depending on how much we pump, we could basically pump a large gradient, faster oscillation, or a very slow oscillation, and both turning the gradient to a plus sign and a minus sign. Again, you cannot see here, you just see a frequency, but we certainly know that we can pump positive and negative gradients. Now, this, as you can see still, gives us nice oscillations, so now we have some well-determined number of revolutions around the x-axis, but there is still a very nice envelope decay here, and the overall time over which we lose this spin information is still of order 10 nanoseconds. So this means that we now have an average gradient. It's not zero, but that average gradient is still fluctuating. So we'd like to do better. And the best way to do better is to basically have the electron determine what the gradient is and to decide whether to pump nuclear spins based on the outcome of what it determined. So whereas before we were just blindly pumping nuclear spins going to here, let's actually ask the electron, what is the gradient? So if you think about this experiment here, this experiment is a measure of the gradient. We see a fast gradient here, fast oscillations, and a slow gradient here. So if we just let the electron evolve for some time, basically oscillate from singlet to triplet, for a well-defined time, let's say up to this point here, and only then, at the end of that experiment, we go and we try to flip some nuclear spin. Okay? So we have now two possibilities. Before, we always started with a singlet. We also knew what the outcome should be. Now we don't know. It depends on the outcome of this evolution. If we ended up in a singlet, then we go on the yellow branch, and we're going to flip to a triplet state, and we're going to flip a nuclear spin. But if we ended up in a triplet state, we're on the red branch, and the red branch here does not intersect T plus, so we don't flip nuclear spins. So now we have, to some extent, a quantum-limited feedback process. This is a situation where the electron, per shot, can determine whether it wants to flip a nuclear spin or not, and basically does that at a very high rate. The nice thing about this feature is that it has internal feedback. Let's imagine that the gradient relaxed just a little bit, and that means that for the same evolution time now, the electron is going to come out more singlet-like rather than triplet-like. And so if it comes out more singlet-like, it means that it will tend to pump more nuclear spins and push the gradient back to its original value. So this has a stabilizing effect that automatically upon, you know, we don't know really what the outcome is. We only set this time, but the electron will then polarize nuclei to make sure that this gradient is preserved for a very long time. And this is what you can see in this data. So this is a typical example without this kind of feedback where the fluctuations gives rise to an envelope that decays over roughly 10, 20 nanoseconds. But with this feedback, we can push it to beyond 100 nanoseconds. Our record right now is nearly 200 nanoseconds of evolution. And this is all due to the fact that now the electron basically determines what the gradient is and decides to pump or not pump nuclei based on that outcome. I want to also emphasize in terms of gate fidelities, typically people tend to determine gate fidelities by counting, well, how many oscillations do I have? And then 1 over that number of oscillations gives me the error. So here, for example, I have 5, so that would mean, you know, 10, 20% error. This is not precise because the envelope here is not exponential. It's actually quadratic. And so there is a square that needs to go into there. So if you have 5 oscillations, your fidelity is going to be 1 over 25. And if you have here something of order, you know, 20 or 30 oscillations, the in-principle fidelity of this gate here could become, you know, 0.99 something. So really, really high. We've mastered this quantum bit in many different ways. We now know how to do quantum state tomography. Here you can see an ensemble of measurements basically allowing this quantum bit to rotate around various axes, and each one of these data points is basically determined by a 3-axis measurement. We project the end state as a function of time on x, y, and z to determine what the density matrix of this quantum bit is, and in just a minute you'll see the same thing being applied to two quantum bits. So I think we have fairly good control of this measurement. This is another indication. One of the nice things about this solid state implementation is that single shot readout is very easy. Here you see rotations from singlet to triplet as a function of time, and you see that the detection very easily indicates that we either detect the singlet or a triplet at any given time. You never detect anything in between, and that's basically the nature of quantum measurement. All right, so single quantum bits, I think we've mastered. Now we're facing the challenge of two quantum bits. This is what we've been spending the past year on, and we've done some important strides there. You'll see in just a minute. First of all, what is the logic of coupling two quantum bits? So as I mentioned, once you're away from this far left corner here, there is a charge difference between the singlet state and the triplet state. Their spatial distribution of the charges is a little bit different. You see that the singlet state is a little bit pushed towards O2 compared to the triplet state, which is more evenly distributed. And so you see that if I have, let's say, one quantum bit in the singlet state, so the two electrons are far to the right, I would have some precession rate around Z of some nearby quantum bit. But if I now flip this quantum bit to the triplet state, this means that the charge distribution of that right qubit has changed, and that charge distribution now pushes a little bit this electron towards the other one. And so that's going to affect the exchange of the other qubit, and so we have basically a state-dependent exchange, and that's the underlying mechanism by which we can generate entanglement. If you think about this, it's just a sigma-z coupling between the two quantum bits. One way to determine how well this kind of two-gate, two-quantum bit operation works is to look at some state fidelity, and the easiest one to think about is a Bell state fidelity. So let's imagine we're trying to create this state. We know how to measure the two-quantum bit density matrix. It involves measuring 16 quantities, and we know how to measure those. And what we can ask is, well, what is the fidelity? What is the mean of this measured density matrix with respect to our desired Bell state? Of course, the larger the number, the better the quality of this gate is. But there is another interesting feature that you learn by looking at Bell state fidelities, and that is that if it exceeds a half, it directly tells you that you have entanglement in the system, because there is no way to select any mixed variety of product states and to get a Bell state fidelity that exceeds a half. So this is something that can be easily proven. Any statistical mixture of product states will always give you a Bell state fidelity that is below one half. And so not only it tells us what the overlap with the Bell state is, it tells us if we have something that exceeds a half, we know that we're entangled. So this is an example of such a measurement. You see here this Bell state fidelity on the left, and the blue curve is the outcome of that measurement. And you see that we start at a half when our entangling gate is zero. And what we're doing is we're just allowing the entanglement to increase as a function of time. And so what you expect is to maximally entangle and then disentangle and entangle again and disentangle. You see that we have quite a bit of decay, but at least in the first few hundred nanoseconds, we can generate Bell state fidelities that certainly exceed a half, go up to roughly 0.7 or 0.75. And then you see that this type of C phase gate continues to evolve, but we go below a half, which means that we cannot claim entanglement beyond this point, but nonetheless, we know that we're generating something that up to decoherence, and we know very well what the sources of decoherence are, is trying to mimic this kind of Bell state fidelity. And we can control the rate of this two-qubit operation, and you see that it's largely linear in our detuning parameters. So I think we now have a fairly good starting point for generating two-qubit operations with these kind of systems. So this is roughly where we are in terms of using this kind of logical spin qubits in gallium arsenide in pushing, I'd say, quantum information processing. The next steps would be, of course, to improve this two-qubit fidelity and to go to larger number of quantum bits and so on. But the road towards really doing quantum computation is very, very long. And we have to ask ourselves, well, is there anything we can do with a few quantum bits that is actually useful and interesting, and that does not require us to have 10 or 15 or 100 quantum bits before we can actually do something interesting. And this is going to be the next part of the talk where I'm going to focus on using quantum bits as sensors. And I'd like to demonstrate that here in this very simple example. So the only ingredients that you really need is to have a quantum bit that you can initialize, you can control, and you can detect. And then you can do some interesting things if it has long coherence. So imagine we think about this two-electron quantum bit. We know that we can initialize it along the z-axis. We can control it, so we can prepare a superposition along the x-axis. And then we can let it evolve in some unknown field. So what happens now is that this superposition is going to process around the z-axis. And after some time, we're going to accumulate some phase, and we can measure what that phase is by projecting onto the north and south pole again. And since we have our ability to detect, we can determine what that phase was. And if we know what the phase was, we can determine what the external field is. And of course, the best thing we can do is to allow the system to evolve and take advantage of its full coherence. So the maximum time here is going to be the coherence time. So if one estimates and says, well, what is the best maximum phase I can get to generate a signal to noise of one, then of course, because we're limited by quantum measurement, of order pi over 2 is going to be the largest angle for which our signal to noise is going to be of order 1. And so signal to noise of order 1 is going to give us a value omega here, which is roughly pi over 2, let's say, divided by this coherence time t2. And if we want to improve our signal to noise beyond that, we could just repeat this measurement over and over again. And just by the central limit theorem, we're going to gain sensitivity as 1 over root n. So if you now basically ask, well, how many times can I repeat this measurement to fit it into 1 second so I get some benchmark of sensitivity? And we think about our magnetic field gradient, which acts along the x-axis as the number we'd like to detect. For this particular quantum bit, we get of order a few nanotesla per root hertz, per 1 second of integration. So you can imagine that this is one way of measuring a magnetic field gradient. And of course, the longer the coherence would be, the better we can measure these gradients. This two-electron quantum bit has another control axis, which is this exchange field. And so that exchange field is actually sensitive to electric fields or to potentials. And so we could ask, well, if we use that quantum bit to measure electric fields, what would be our sensitivity there? And it turns out that it's of order 1 nanovolt per root hertz. And this is actually quite interesting because, you know, if you want to measure electric fields or potentials locally, one way to do it would be using a single electron transistor. Single electron transistors are typically shot noise limited. You need to drive current in order to detect their signal. This system is not shot noise limited. The system is really freely operating during the evolution time. You then only measure it after you've after it evolved. And so this is really not limited by shot noise, and in principle, already gives results which are comparable or even better than what SETs do, and I think could be pushed further. So this is just the general concept. But the other feature about these things is that the quantum bit is fairly small, and so we'd like to use this notion of measuring one of its control parameters, not only very precisely, but also with good spatial resolution. And for that, the two-electron quantum bit is not necessarily so good because the electrons in semiconductors span a diameter of order 100 nanometers. We'd like something that has a better spatial resolution. One motivation would be to measure magnetic fields or magnetic field gradients with very high precision. So what kind of sources would we be interested in? So here is an example of what the magnetic field of a single electron would be as a function of distance. Let's say we're looking at 10 nanometers away from this electron spin. It turns out that 1 microtesla is generated. So, you know, having a few nanotesla per root hertz should be plenty in order to detect 1 electron spin at a distance of 10 nanometers. If one wants to look at the proton spin, it's about 1,000 times smaller. You see that it's more challenging of order 1 nanotesla. But I think the message here is that if we want to be able to detect individual spin, individual dipoles, we need to be close. And this means that we need to have our quantum bit be small, will be comparable to this distance. If it's of order 100 nanometers, there's no way we're going to have to put here 100, and this R cube is going to kill us very, very rapidly. Just to give you a sense of, you know, whether this kind of approach, using a quantum bit to measure some external field, is that useful or not, so let me give you some examples of other ways of measuring magnetic fields. This is, for example, a squid or a scanning squid, pioneered by several groups, but these are results from Cam Moeller's group at Stanford. They have been now able to push the sensitivity. You know, it's a little bit hard to translate sensitivities because the squid measures flux and we are interested in comparing magnetic field, but okay, if you take typical pickup loops, you end up with about 10 nanotesla per root hertz, but the size scale over which you're able to detect these kind of magnetic fields is given by the size of the loop, so it's about 0.3 microns. You'll see that there's always a competition between size and sensitivity. This is a scanning hall bar. Has, you know, a smaller size scale of averaging, but a poorer sensitivity of order 10 to the minus 4 tesla per root hertz. This is quite a remarkable technique operating at low temperature, UHV, magnetic resonance force microscopy. I don't want to go into too much detail. Several groups, I think that really the person who's pushing this forward is Dan Rugard, Almaden. Here you see not a bad sensitivity of order 10 nanotesla per root hertz and a fairly good spatial resolution of order 50 nanometers. Of course, you can do even better. You could take clouds of atoms that have very, very precise lines that could be extremely sensitive to magnetic field. In fact, they're not that sensitive to magnetic field, but the lines are so narrow, you can get phenomenal sensitivities of order 10 to the minus 13 tesla per root hertz, but then the averaging volume is about a millimeter. So you can put all these together to get a relation between sensitivity and the size scale over which this field sensor is averaging. And you immediately note the trend. You can get very high sensitivities, 10 to the minus 15 tesla per root hertz, on a scale of a meter. But if you want something that operates at very low length scales, you're giving up a lot of sensitivity. Now, if our target is detecting one dipole, we know what our requirement is in terms of sensitivity versus distance, because the field is dropping off as 1 over r cubed. So this is what this yellow line here is showing. If you want to measure this electron spin very close, then you don't need that high of a sensitivity. If you want to measure it at a distance of, you know, a few millimeters, then you need phenomenal sensitivity. And what this plot is actually showing is the right approach to detect individual electrons is really on the nanoscale. Going down to small dimensions, you lose sensitivity, but somehow you're gaining signal much faster. So we want to push ourselves down to here. We've already indicated sensitivities in the order of a few nanotesla per root hertz. So both the nitrogen vacancy center, I'll show that in just a minute, and the spin qubits in gallium arsenide give you that kind of sensitivity. The real question is, what is the size scale over which you're averaging? Can we get ourselves down to this submicron domain? So this is where we got interested in nitrogen vacancy centers. It turns out that these are basically defects that replace one carbon atom with nitrogen and leaves a nearby site vacant. I don't want to go into detail. I just want to flash a little bit of the resemblance between this system and the one that I have described in detail. It turns out that the physics describing this complex is basically that of two holes. They're all together eight orbitals here that are allowed to be filled. Six are filled with electrons. There are two vacancies. And so this system, again, very similar to the two electrons I've described, that now these are two holes, so not that different. Again, we need to be able to initialize, control, and detect. It turns out that initialization and detection are done by using shining light onto the system. And again, the readout, the conversion of spin to something, is a transient phenomena. You see that if you measure the number of photons emitted from this defect as a function of time, at long times you don't see a difference between a zero and a one state. But at some transient times of order a few hundred nanoseconds, you can see a difference and you can determine whether your system is in a zero or one state. Okay, so again, I'm not going into the details, but the analogy here is the transient. Control in this system is done using conventional ESR. We just have microwaves. Relatively high power microwaves coming down and allowing us to control this two-level system between a zero and a one state, which again, these are two electron states. with fairly high frequencies. Looking at echo for this particular spin, remember that we saw recurrences that had to do with commensurate dynamics between the electron spin and the nuclear environment. You see a very, very similar picture for diamond. These are recurrences that occur. The nuclear bath in diamond consists of carbon-13s and gallium arsenide. It's the gallium and arsenic isotopes that have nuclear spins that give rise to the nuclear environment. But very, very similar recurrence physics. And again, a very similar slow envelope decay of this echo function, indicating that the bath is slow to evolve, very non-Markovian, allowing us to extend coherence essentially as much as we desire if we have good control over the electron spin. So we've used this nitrogen vacancy to determine magnetic sensitivity, sensitivity to an external magnetic field, and we find something that's similar to our gallium arsenide quantum dot, again, a few of order, a few tens of nanotesla per root hertz. And again, just putting the NV center here on the same plot. So we have fairly decent sensitivity. The question is really, what is the size scale? Now, the unique feature about nitrogen vacancy center compared to the gallium arsenide, this defect is atomic in size. So in principle, you can imagine that I can bring that defect very, very close to an electron spin, and then gain a lot of signal and maybe be able to detect an electron spin, and you know, maybe in some future years a nuclear spin. So just a few words about sensitivity. When you're trying to detect a dipole, you should think about two possible targets. A simpler one to imagine is one where the target spins are frozen. Let's say a ferromagnet or an anti-ferromagnet. Right, all these spins, you cannot really flip them around. There is a huge energy scale associated with flipping each one of these spins that you want to image, and so your resolution is going to be directly dictated by the distance between your sensor, in this case would be some nitrogen vacancy center, and your surface. And so here, the only way to achieve good resolution would be to reduce this distance. Another alternative, if you're interested in something that you can actually modulate, for example, you have some free spins that you want to measure, then you can imagine selectively flipping each one of these spins using, for example, a magnetic field gradient, very similar to what's done in NMR or MRI. If you had large enough gradients, you could allow only this one to process and the rest not, and you can basically lock in to that one. So your resolution now is not directly related to the distance to your detector, but also convolved with your ability to flip only one spin in the vicinity of some other spins in the sample. And so there are basically two things that you need in order to tackle both of these. One is to reduce the distance between your sensor and the sample. And for that, I'll describe a little bit this monolithic diamond tip approach. And here, you want to create very large gradients. And for that, we've been playing around with magnetic tips that allow us to create fairly large gradients and resolve spins that are separated by less than 10 nanometers. I'm running quite late on time. I think maybe five more minutes. So just quickly, what a magnetic field gradient would do is it will basically allow us to tune into resonance one spin and not another. This is what the outcome of the experiment looks like if you just image as function of position, you're moving a field gradient. Then you see that there is going to be a constant field contour in space for which a target spin comes into resonance. Okay, so there is some nitrogen vacancy center here that we're trying to detect. And as we're moving our gradient around, we see that we're getting some suppressed readout in a ring. And that basically ring corresponds to a constant field contour. The details here are not that important, but the nice thing is that if we have multiple spins, then we can see for each one of these spins, we're going to get a different ring. And they're just offset by one another. And we could very easily find what is the pointing vector that relates each one of these rings to the other and determine the position of these individual spins with good resolution of order, 8 or 9 nanometers and very good precision. So that's how a magnetic field gradient can could help. In principle, if we could push this further, we'd like to go down to sub-nanometer spatial resolution to be able to study structure on very fine length scales. In order to address bringing an NV center very, very close to a target, what we'd like to do is we'd like to be able to create an imaging system, basically a tip, that has only one NV center sitting of order a few nanometers from the surface. And here you could see just one platform here that has several of these pillars. Each one of these pillars has one nitrogen vacancy center sitting at the apex, roughly 10 nanometers from the surface. This is the outcome of this entire process. There are several steps in creating that. We first make these tips. We then carve platforms, and then we transfer them onto a quartz tip and putting them into our imaging system. And then we can basically image with that. And this is a fairly old slide that we have that we're basically imaging some magnetic hard drive here. And you could see the domains. It's not the ideal sample to look with this kind of NV sensitivity because the sensitivity of the NV center is so high that it's saturated at any location here except for the very, very sharp transitions that you see between one domain and the other. The purpose of this kind of imaging is just to tell us, well, what is the distance between our sample and the surface? And from these kind of images, we can determine that it's of order 30 nanometers. As of last week, and I don't have slides to show, we are actually able to image individual electrons using this technique with a resolution of order 50 nanometers. So we're very excited. I think we're the first time that we're actually able to see one electron spin with this kind of imaging technique. So I think we're right now somewhere here. We're able to detect an individual electron. And of course, we have a long ways to go if we want to move further down in this direction towards detecting single protons. But there isn't really anything that's fundamentally blocking, especially what determines coherence is, what determines sensitivity is coherence. And this bath is really this non-Markovian bath. We can push coherence out by playing these kind of decoupling tricks. And so we can really hope to extend coherence and improve sensitivity to a large degree. So with this, I'd like to summarize the two portions of the talk that are running in parallel in my group. The two electron quantum bit experiments have been carried out by a variety of students and postdocs, in particular Hendrik Bloom, Sandra Folletti, Mikey Schulman, and Oliver Dial. And the experiments on the nitrogen vacancy centers are carried out by Mike Grinnell, Sung Kun Hong, and Patrick Malatinsky. And we've been enjoying fruitful collaboration with three other groups at Harvard studying nitrogen vacancy centers, that of Marco Lonkar, Misha Lukin, and Ron Molesworth. Thank you.